Hello and welcome back to my channel. If you don't know me, my name is Sosa. I'm a software engineer who talks about engineering things and also finance. And today I'm gonna be giving a 1 year update on the property that I bought a year ago. Last year I bought a single family home, a 3-bedroom, 1-bath down south in Georgia. Also as context, I live in California as a software engineer. So this was out of state property for me and it was my first rental investment. So scary and risky all around. So I bought it in the summer and then had it leased and had a tenant in the fall of 2019. So my property management will send me a payment at the end of the month or middle of the month or whatever. That will be kind of the cash flow that I get from them after the tenant pays and after they've already taken their chunk. And so all that money gets deposited into a checking account, which is separate from my personal account. So all these numbers are from Stessa. I kind of went through last night to kind of clean up a lot of the data that was in there because some things weren't categorized right or whatever. And so just trying to make sure all the numbers are correct. Starting with appreciation, the property when I bought it was around $100,000. I put 20% down. I think my interest rate at the time was 4.75. I think they have to do the appraisal before they give you a loan or something like that. So when I did the appraisal at the time, it came out to 115. So $115,000. For me, this property is buy and hold. So I really don't plan on selling the property anytime soon. But anyway, it's an 11.2% return on just appreciation. So in terms of cash flow for this last year, I've had a 21.8% 12-month cash on cash return. Significantly better than like the average stock market return. 21% is kind of crazy. And I think most investors are looking for 14% or more when they're looking at cash on cash return for a property. And what that means in terms of dollar amounts, after property management takes their cut, taxes and the mortgage payment and insurance, I get I think the exact number is $518 a month. Again, after a bunch of things, but before maintenance and capital expenditures. I usually put aside, and if you've seen my spreadsheet that I shared in my previous video, I put aside in that spreadsheet, I think it was 7% for bigger ticket items like the roof and like the HVAC, a bunch of like really bigger things, 7%. And then another 7% put towards maintenance. That total would be 14%. So I do 14 to 20% is about $175 to $250 a month. And then the rest is cash flow. So from around $250 to $300, I give myself as cash flow. That just goes into a separate savings account. I use Ally Bank, and so you can have a bunch of different savings accounts. So I have one savings account that's just like specific for maintenance and CapEx. And then I have a separate account for like cash flow that I could use on down payments, which is what I would want the cash flow to be for. Maybe even use it for closing costs, who knows? Since it's Ally Bank, they do high yield savings accounts. All the money sits in there. And it's been sitting in there since 2019, obviously. So interest from having my money sitting in a high yield savings account has been a little over $50. So $52.99 in interest coming from there, that is free and clear. Basic rundown, 21, almost 22% in cash on cash return, $250 to $300 in cash flow. And this doesn't even include like tax benefits or anything like that. This is just like the money that I see in my account. And so moving on, maintenance issues, anything that's come up. So for some context, basically I'd wiped out my account to buy the investment property. I made sure though to have a little bit of padding just in case anything happened or if I needed to do any repairs. And so I left about $2,500. I ended up using all of that and a little bit more, I think. 2 months in particular. In December of 2019, a couple months after the tenants had moved in, there was something wrong with the plumbing, so the toilet kept getting clogged. There were electricity problems. At some point, the tenants didn't have electricity in like half the house or something. And then there was also no hot water at some point in time. Again, remember, I have property management, so they handle all the requests for these things, and they kind of just like send me a bill and say, hey, pay for this. In the month of December, I remember just getting back-to-back work orders of like, hey, this is broken, we need money to fix it. Hey, this is also broken, we need some money. You know, know, it was kind of stressful, but luckily it didn't add up to be too much money. I think in December, a little over $300 in repairs that were needed. And then in April 2020, the toilet ended up getting clogged again, but they ended up fixing it, so they canceled the order, the work order. Two, there was water leaking from the basement, and this was actually a huge deal. So basically, there was an issue, I think, with the roof. Like, there was an added section to the house that was added before I bought it to make another room or like office. I guess it was leaking. The roof was leaking, and then also something in the basement was leaking. Basically, the roof wasn't done properly. So they had to remove a part of the roof and then install new decking or like shingles or something. That ended up being $2,485 in repairs just for April of 2020. And that was really hard. And I mean, like, there are definitely other investors who have had it harder for them in 2020. I've been extremely lucky that my tenant has been amazing, and like property management has been great, and they have been taking care of everything. So really, I don't have to deal with the day-to-day things. I've just been really blessed to be in that position, honestly. But when I did get that repair bill, I was like, oh my gosh, like, that's so much money. Basically wiped out all the savings and padding that I had. That was the money that I had saved just in case of emergencies. It wasn't fun, you know, to have to pay for that bill, but luckily it wasn't something that happened again and again. Like, they fixed it back in April and I haven't heard anything. So that was all the repairs that have happened between 2019 and 2020. Really only 2 months that really gave me a headache. And if I were to do the calculations, it would have wiped out not my cash flow, but it would have wiped out my maintenance amount, like the amount that I put aside every month for repairs. So some closing thoughts. For me, as a first-time investor, I think this has been, I feel like I've had a pretty good experience with all of this. It could have been way worse, obviously, but for the most part, this has been pretty much hands-off. And my goal moving forward would be to hopefully get another investment property around the same price range. Remember to take these numbers for the most part as like a grain of salt. Like, they're obviously accurate, right? But this is just my first year, and I don't want to speak negatively or anything like that, but just being realistic, you're not always going to see these numbers year after year after year. Just like in the stock market, 1 year you could have a bull run of like 14% return, and then the next year have like a single digit returns. You know, you can't really predict it, and I'm just really happy that it's done well in this first year. And this is just advice specific to anybody who is looking to get into real estate. Please make sure to do your own research, run your own numbers, take everything anyone says with a grain of salt until, like, you know, you are really confident in your ability to know what a deal is and what's not a deal. It can be a lot of time to put into it, but it'll be worth it. And this is something that you do not want to mess up. Yeah, I hope this video was helpful. If you have any more questions, comments, concerns, please leave them down below as always, and I will see you in the next one.